Everybody to the GINA online seminar. Our speaker today is Konstantinos Konstantinou. He graduated from Stony Brook in 2013, and then he was a postdoc in Jülich, and now he's at Ohio University working with Prakash, and he will tell us about enforcing causality in non-relativistic equations of state. So please start.
Thank you, Ingo. So the plan for today's talk is to briefly review some general properties of the speed of sound, and then proceed to discuss a couple of methods by which we can restore causality to non-relativistic equations of state which happen to violate it. So for small amplitude perturbations, the velocity of particles in a compressible perfect fluid adheres to the wave equation, in which the speed of sound, CS, represents a physical scale which controls the evolution of the system. Since we are talking about the small perturbations, basically this equation is the result of linearization of the Euler and the continuity equation of fluid mechanics, because we are dealing with small perturbations and therefore we can do this. Furthermore, because we are dealing with perfect fluids which have no viscosity or thermal diffusion, it means that the motion described by this equation is adiabatic. That is, the entropy of each fluid element is constant in time. But that does not necessarily mean that it's constant across the fluid. That would be isentropic motion, and in that case, that is a special case of the adiabatic motion in this context. So when we have adiabatic motion, basically the pressure, small variations in the pressure are reflected in small variations in the energy density, and this forms the physical content of the defining equation for the speed of sound, as the derivative of the pressure with respect to the energy density at a fixed entropy. And we can use standard thermodynamics to connect it to the adiabatic compressibility. Here, mu is the chemical potential, and also the adiabatic index, where H is the enthalpy density, which is the sum of the energy density and the pressure. If we transform these equations into the variables density and temperature from density and entropy, we can also connect the speed of sound to the ratio of the specific heats at constant pressure and volume, and also the isothermal compressibility. So as a property of the equation of state, the speed of sound is very important in astrophysical phenomena, such as supernovae and binary mergers. For example, in the context of supernovae, the speed of sound controls the size of the homologous core during the collapse of a massive star. Basically, at the surface of this homologous core, the velocity of infalling particles has to equal the speed of sound in the medium. It also the speed of sound also determines the mass transfer rate into the accretion shock after the core rebounds. And in this equation, n is the local density and f is just a numerical factor of order unity. In binary neutrons and mergers, the speed of sound determines the production of thermal energy when initially cold fluid, the particles begin to collide. So that's basically that point in the merger, in the Einstein spiral, at which the two objects begin to exchange the matter. It also has, the speed of sound also has technical importance in the context of simulations of this kind of events, because it controls the cost of the simulation. Too large a speed of sound will limit the time step size, for example. And also, if we have a superluminal speed of sound, simulations that are carried out in full general relativity will fail. Now, in what is a typical exercise in the equation of state game? For small deviations from the equilibrium density of symmetric nuclear matter and for small isospin asymmetries, we can express the energy of nucleonic matter in terms of the binding energy, the compression modulus, the skewness, symmetry energy, and the cell parameter, which is related to the slope of the symmetry energy. And of course, we can do this also for the pressure and any other state function of the system. And using these equations for the energy and the pressure in this kind of expansion, we can also express the speed of sound in terms of saturation observables. And while this equation looks kind of complicated, if we look at specific instances, for example, symmetric nuclear matter, pure neutral matter, or beta equilibrium matter at the equilibrium density, we find that the speed of sound mostly depends on the compression modulus and the cell parameter, which is not surprising, of course, because these are the symmetric and asymmetric compressibilities. And the speed of sound is, I mean, I showed earlier that it's in general related to the compressibility. Another instructive exercise with regards to the speed of sound is to study its behavior in several limiting situations. For example, if we look at a non-relativistic gas with interactions that can be completely described with an effective mass, then we find that the speed of sound squared goes as 2/3 times this factor Q, which basically involves the effective mass and then the derivative of the effective mass with respect to density. Obviously, in a free gas, this will reduce again to 2 over 3, because in that case, Q is just 1. If we look at the extreme relativistic limit, we find that the speed of sound is Q over 3, reducing to 1 over 3, which is the standard for ultra-relativistic particles with no interactions. But a more interesting result can be obtained when we look at systems described by with interactions which can be described by an effective mass as well as a density-independent potential. If we look at this kind of system in the non-degenerate limit, that is the limit of high temperatures, high entropies, we find that the speed of sound depends only on the thermal components of the pressure and the energy density, because the cold matter contributions are quite small relative to these guys. And if we further increase the temperature so that even the contributions of the rest mass are small, then we end up with an expression for the speed of sound in the limit of very large temperatures, very high entropies, that depends only on the effective mass and its derivative, both of which are cold matter properties. So we have an expression for the speed of sound at large temperatures, which does not depend on the entropy or the temperature. And this will come handy later when we are trying to study causality violation in non-relativistic systems. Now, the most natural way to make sure that causality is respected for all densities and temperatures is to work in a framework that incorporates Lorentz covariance and special relativity from the beginning. And in the equation of state game, that usually means we have to work with relativistic mean field theories. And I'm showing an example of such a theory here, where the nuclear-nuclear interaction is mediated by the exchange of sigma, omega, and rho mesons, scalar, vector, and isovector. The mean field approximation basically means that we neglect the meson field fluctuations and replace the fields by their expectation values, and in which the nucleons move independently. And we also take the system to be uniform and static, which means that the fields do not depend on the space-time coordinates. With these assumptions, we can derive the equations of motion for the mesons and the nucleons using the Euler-Lagrange equations, and also we can get the thermodynamics from the stress-energy tensor. So once we have the energy and the pressure, obviously, getting the speed of sound is not particularly difficult. It's just an exercise in algebra. And for this particular model, I show the speed of sound at zero temperature. And it has the desired behavior in that it approaches 1 asymptotically from below. And this would also be the case at finite temperature, even though I'm not showing it here. Now, in the next few slides, the plan is to discuss causality violation and how to fix it, using standard non-relativistic models. And so for these purposes, I just want to talk for a couple of minutes about the Skerm and the Latimer stress, the energy density functionals, which I will use for illustrative purposes. So the structure of a typical Skerm model basically has kinetic energy terms that are related to momentum and spin exchange, which operationally mix the kinetic energy densities and the number densities of the two nucleon species, which means which result in effective masses for the nucleons. There are potential terms which grow as the square of the density, reflecting two-body interactions, and there are also terms in the potential which grow faster than the square of the density, and these encode higher than two-body interactions. And this part of the potential is necessary in order to get in order to reproduce the empirical saturation properties. The Latimer Suresti EDF does not have the exchange term, so it doesn't have an effective mass. But it still contains the usual kinetic energy terms and some two and higher body interactions in the potential. Now, when our description of nucleonic matter is based on non-relativistic models, we have no a priori guarantee that the causality will be respected. And even if we should happen to come across a model which respects causality at zero temperature, that does not mean that it will do so also at finite temperature. And the opposite is true as well, right? I mean, if I have a model that violates causality at zero temperature, it may very well become causal at higher temperatures. And one way to examine whether the model we are considering violates causality at any point in density or temperature is to look at the speed of sound at the extreme cases at zero entropy and at infinite entropy. So the zero entropy calculation is very simple, right? We just take derivatives of the cold energy and of the cold pressure with respect to the density. Whereas for the infinite entropy limit, we just use the equation that I had shown before, which depends only on the effective mass and derivatives of the effective mass with respect to intensity. And the results of this exercise are shown in these three plots. Basically for APR, which is Skerm-like, for Latimer-Suresti energy density function, and for SLY4, which is a Skerm model. The black curves in all of these plots are basically the two limiting cases. And all other curves, all curves of intermediate entropy or temperature, have to lie between these ones. So essentially they form the boundaries of the region in which the speed of sound as a function of the density is allowed to live. From these plots, for example, the APR and the LS plots are qualitatively similar in that initially, for lower densities, curves for the speed of sound corresponding to higher entropies are more robust, but the situation is reversed at higher entropies after we have this kind of crossover points, which and this crossover point is a fixed point and can be determined by setting the two limiting cases for the speed of sound as equal. Another feature of the Latimer-Suresti speed of sound is the fact that for very large entropies, it becomes the two-thirds value, which is characteristic of the ideal gas. And that has to do with, it's related to the fact that there's no effective mass in this particular model. And in these two models, the causality, the intensity at which causality is violated actually increases and even disappears as the temperature is increased. On the other hand, when we look at the SLY4 model, we find that the causality violating density shifts to lower densities as the temperature is increased, because the speed of sound in that case is a monotonically increasing function of the temperature and the entropy. So one way by which we can restore causality to such models basically stems from the observation that causality violation has to do with terms in the potential which vary faster than the square of the density. And this kind of terms can be, basically we need some kind of a mechanism by which we screen these higher body interactions. And one way to do this is by making this kind of substitution in this terms which of the density that are higher, that have an exponent higher than 2. In this expression, the exponent delta controls the softening of the equation of state with maximal softening for delta equals zero and much more the minimal softening with delta equals one. And I show basically the results for the speed of sound in this plot. The original version of the Lattimore-Suesti speed of sound for the pure matter, pure neutral matter configuration shown in the black dashed curve, whereas the other two situations are shown in red and blue. And basically what we have succeeded is to soften the equation of state at high densities, but still retain the low density characteristics. These are plots for the energy per particle on the left, I guess, and the pressure on the right. Again, softening due to the introduction of this this denominator, which is not entirely, I guess, physically unmotivated. If we take it, the sigma to be one and delta to be zero, it looks like an infinite geometric sum of n-body correlations, right? So in any case, we have some softening at higher densities. We produce the low density characteristics of the original equation of state from about two times equilibrium density and below. But in some cases, this softening may be too much. For example, when I take delta to be one, the properties of the maximum mass neutron stars for this particular equation of state suffer. Right? I mean, I'm getting from an original mass of 2.3, which is well above the lower limit on the maximum mass, I end up with a 1.7. Right? So it's kind of a failure. We want softening, but not extreme one. Now, another method by which you can restore causality to offending models is thermodynamically motivated. So, and the basic idea is to express the causality condition as the first order differential equation, and which you have to integrate. And in order to integrate this equation of state, we have to choose the functional form that the speed of sound will take above some value in the calculation from the original model, both the causality fixing value of the speed of sound as well as the functional form of the speed of sound are up to us. And we integrate this differential equation numerically or analytically in some special cases. And we end up with results for the energy density and the pressure with integration constants which only depend on the density at which we have made the transition from the old version of the speed of sound to the new. And if we use a speed of sound which is constant, then the expressions, the integration can be done analytically. And it results to very simple expressions for both the energy and the pressure. And here the subscript f basically denotes quantities which are calculated in the original Hamiltonian, but at the density at which you have fixed the speed of sound. And the results of this exercise are shown in this plot here. The left panel is the speed of sound for fixed entropies and the right for fixed temperatures. And the solid curves show what happens after we implement causality, whereas the dotted lines are the original predictions of the model. So the task to restore causality is achieved. And this is what happens to some of the state functions of the system once you implement causality. Energy density is on the left, pressure is on the right. We have some softening, more so for the pressure. And this is a feature that all state functions which are related to derivatives with respect to density of the energy density, which are, for example, pressure, the chemical potential, the specific heat at constant pressure, will show more softening than, for example, the entropy or the specific heat at constant volume. And also the deviations from the original curves depend also on at which density we choose to fix to make this transition from the old speed of sound to the new. And in this table, again, I list properties of the maximum mass neutron stars for APR and for the Ladimir-Suest equation of state for different values at which we fix the speed of sound. The last column in each of these are the stars as predicted by the pre-implementation equation of state, whereas the other three columns are for increasing values of the speed of sound. And basically, what we see is that as we increase the value at which we fix the speed of sound, the maximum mass, the central density, the central energy density, and the central pressure approach the pre-implementation values from below, whereas the maximum radius does so from above. Now, in the case of LS, this column, the 0.9 column, is the same as the original star. And that has to do with the fact that the central density of the star is lower than the density at which the implementation of causality would begin. And this is pretty much all I had to say. So I just want to reiterate the importance of the speed of sound in simulations of astrophysical phenomena, both with regards to physics as well as on the technical side of things. Non-relativistic models do not have to respect causality, and most often they don't. But we can find out whether they violate causality even before we do a full finite temperature calculation using the expressions at zero and infinite entropy. And if we find that causality is violated, we have a couple of tools by which we can implement it. We can bring it back. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. If anyone has questions, please indicate so in the chat so that I know, and then I will call you. But we start. We have some questions by Jérôme.
Okay, thank you very much for... So thank you very much for this very nice presentation. I have a kind of general question about maybe the two ways that you propose for enforcing the causality. So if I understand correctly, the first method that you propose is a kind of correction of the density dependence of the so-called three-body force in this effective interaction. And yes. Somehow, so this has to do with many-body interaction. So the contribution of the respective or the collective contribution of three-body, four-body, and so on contribution. So do you agree with this interpretation of your correction to this so-called three-body force?
Yeah, I think basically this kind of a correction is a screening of the higher body forces, right? At least in scare models and the models with which have only contact interactions, higher body forces basically produce terms in density which vary faster than the square of the density. Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, this is usually what it's done with the N2 plus epsilon term in scare models, for example. So, and these are the terms which cause causality that violate causality, and therefore, basically, by using some kind of a screening mechanism like this one, we are able to maintain their effects at low densities, but take them out of the picture essentially at higher densities. Mm-hmm.
So, therefore, I mean, there may be a way in the future to try to control this correction by a better knowledge of the many-body interaction. I don't know, from an effective approach or from a chiral EFT approach or
something. Yeah, I'm not an expert in the chiral interactions, but there's still, if anybody has a comment on that, I'd like to hear it too.
No, because I mean, my question is somehow, I mean, this extra parameter you cannot use only causality to tune these parameters because it could be that it's physical that your equation of state become a causal. To take the causality as a target to correct the equation of state is interesting, but it would be interesting to have a confirmation that the physics is really following your correction. I mean, this is my impression at first.
I mean, why would causality be violated? I mean, in general, there's no reason for it, right? Now, what I'm doing with this kind of a term, I'm screening higher body interactions and I'm giving myself one more parameter. So in principle, I can still fit the original properties. So if I'm looking at to fit properties at the equilibrium density, for example, this the three curves that I show here, around the equilibrium density will give me exactly the same numbers for the symmetry energy or the compression modulus or all of those things.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what I mean is that a way to prevent causality is, for instance, to have a phase transition with all the particles. Yeah, of course.
I mean, this is completely. This is.
What I mean is it could be that the approach at that more or less tuned at low density from what we know from nuclear physics doesn't work at 4, 5, 6 times saturation density. But if there is a phase transition that replace the approach by something different, then we should not really care about that.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, obviously, both of the approaches that I have shown are essentially artificial. And they're just the goal is to take existing models and just fix them at high densities. I mean, there's no, obviously, I mean, there could very well be a phase transition at some density at which point, obviously, the nucleonic description doesn't hold, and then there's not a problem. I agree with that statement, yes. So this is just basically, this is just a tool to fix something that's broken. But the best approach would obviously be to perhaps replace it with something that's not from the beginning.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you very much for your answers.
Okay. I also had a question. You showed this this figure of APR with at different temperatures. I think it was more before. Why was there this fixed point? Is there some reason that there's this fixed point in the...
Basically, it just means that if I subtract this from this, it has a solution. That's pretty much the answer.
But why is this in APR and better mass velocity but not in SLY?
It has to do with the effective mass, right? I mean, if we look at this equation, it basically depends on in the SLY form, or somehow the effective mass changes in such a way that these equations don't have a solution.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions? You can just go ahead and ask if you have one. Okay, if not, then let's thank Konstantinos again. And I would like to make an announcement. So in a month we have the GINA Frontiers meeting, and if you would all go to the website, there's a sub page for the unconference, and you all can make suggestions for unconference sessions that we can have. So I wanted to encourage you to go there and make a suggestion. So thank you very much, and see you all next time. Bye-bye.
Bye.